Where'd Randy go, Michelle? I'm sorry, go ahead. Well, good evening, everybody. Those of you who are here and those watching on live stream, either live or you'll be watching later. Tonight will be the launching of this month-long emphasis on the spirit of truth and the spirit of error, contrasting the both so we can discern what the dynamics are in modern Christianity. Tonight's scheduled message was supposed to be the five solas of the Reformation, which are the five basic principles that gelled the reformers. Again, Baptists are not Protestant. We actually predated the Reformation, but afterwards, those five solas became foundational to the way Baptist faith finally came into full fruition in the 1600s and 1700s. So it's good for us to know what they are. But Pastor Joe got sick this morning and had to go home and wasn't able to be here. So I'm going to do the introduction to the series with an overview of what the challenge really is. So before I get to that, let's do some prayer requests. I want to pray for Pastor Joe, just some stomach disorders he had, but for his brother who is declining at a rapid rate from his battle with cancer, probably only a few weeks to live. For Kathy Daniels and Jerry, what is the update on Luke? Great. And then Alea.
Yeah, she's better.
Okay. Right. But pray for the Daniels in Texas as they deal with the premature birth of a child and then a temporary illness with the daughter and just all the stress that's involved in that. And then for Russ and Sylvia, who will be leaving soon, now with a little two-week delay on their departure. And I do want to thank all those of you who gave for the offering for the Daniels. It was about $2,000 over their stated goal, which is just wonderful. All that money will be well spent, I have no doubt, and used for the glory of the Lord. But thank you for giving like that. Want to continue to pray for Ed Domzowski, that he'll keep recovering from his esophageal cancer surgery, in which they removed about 8 to 10 inches of his esophagus and pulled the stomach up and reattached it, that he'll continue to heal there. If you would pray for him on that. And then for Drew Peters' sister-in-law, who on Saturday was in an accident sitting at a stoplight with her children and was hit by a drunk driver. They weren't seriously injured, but it was a traumatic experience, but one that enhanced their faith. Less than a year ago, they were also in a truck, and she was breastfeeding her child when the husband got out of the car to do something, and the car rolled forward and was going to roll off a steep drop-off, but it hit a tree instead and saved them from going over the edge. That's all happened in 1 year to this family, and it just made them believe that the Lord's taking care of them. But please pray for them if you would. And then for this Sunday, as we launch this study, and by the way, for those who are watching and haven't seen the email, after the morning service this Sunday, I would like to present to you a general 3 to 5 year plan of what we're going to do next, because we have the great opportunity come September the 1st of TCA having fully moved over to their new campus. And it's a partnership that we want to continue. They've been a great blessing to the church, and we've been integral to their growth and establishment as a school. But it's time for them to move over to their new property and their temporary facilities on modulars. But that will free us up to do a few things that we want to discuss with you, so you'll begin to pray about it and know where we are headed as best we can foresee in the next 3 to 5 years. And within 5 years, it's very likely there could be 20, 25,000 people living from where our church is east. All that open area will be full of neighborhoods and shopping centers and schools and maybe even a few more churches. But we could be debt-free and positioned in the fastest-growing, newest neighborhood in Sarasota. And we have such great potential. I want to take 15 minutes to explain that to you. And the service won't go long, and neither will that. We won't have Sunday school afterwards. It'll just be that presentation, but I hope you'll stay for it. Let's bow together in prayer, then we'll go into tonight's study. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the great blessing this past Sunday of the generosity of the people of faith, so heartily contributing to Russ and Sylvia's return to Uganda, that they'll be able to leave with a positive sense that their needs will be met and this transition will be smooth, and you'll provide the other items that are necessary to make the relocation possible, and that you will bless them even in this delay that's allowing them to be there for their children and their grandchildren. And we thank you for that. We also pray for Kathy and David as they deal with this premature born son Luke and their daughter who had an episode this week, that you'll give them comfort and strength and peace and grace. For Ed Domzowski as he recovers from his surgery. For Mary McNamara, who is in for years now, has just been struggling with some severe physical challenges and is in church every time she can be, but has had to have some major procedures done recently, and I pray that you will sustain her. And then for Lisa Williams, who is having a cancerous lump removed from her leg on Monday, that they'll be able to get the rest of the melanoma that they missed in the first procedure, and then she'll get a clean bill of health and be able to recover. And then for Drew Peters' sister-in-law and that family as they deal with this accident, just the trauma and stress it caused to the children. And then, Father, we do pray that you'll give us wisdom, you'll give us sensitivity and insight as we cover some potentially controversial issues in this month as we look at what really is biblical faith and how it's being challenged today. And we pray that you'll bless this study tonight in Jesus' name. Amen. Tonight we're going to address the basic issue of false prophets. What are they? How do you recognize them? What are the different forms of that? And how do we know if we're not a false prophet? And I want to make a comment about what we see in ministry taking place today. There are no pastors and there are no churches that are perfect or who are without sin. Pastors who fall into financial sin or sexual sin or egregious, prideful sins, whatever that might be, that is one challenge the church faces. But another are false prophets that are within the church with the intent of taking advantage of the church. And that's what we're going to address tonight. So one of the greatest threats to the strength of Christianity is covert, not overt. And this series is going to address the covert assaults on Christianity, not the ones you can readily recognize because the assault is always frontal, but the assaults that are coming from within the church that weaken its character, weaken its discernment, and weaken its allegiance to Scripture. And these forces that are now existing and active in the church today are often not recognized, they're not identified, so they can't be removed and they can't be dealt with properly. It is not the openly different religions that are the greatest challenge to Christianity. It's the subtle misrepresentations of truth that are existing and communicating and spreading within the Church of Jesus Christ that, to me, cause the greatest damage to true biblical faith. The serpent asked Eve in the garden, "Yea, has God said?" And he used that question to cause her to doubt. Maybe she didn't even really hear God accurately. And with that moment of doubt, he was able to say to her, "You will not surely die, but your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God." And it's a different presentation, almost as if this is what God really intended, and you misheard him. And this is his concern. Now, this is too much knowledge for you to have, but I will show you how you can handle it. However he presented it, it began with a subtle question, did God really say that? And that is the way often incorrect, dangerous, and possibly even perverted doctrine sneaks into a well-intended church. So the covert damage is inflicted both intentionally and unintentionally. And we must show grace to those who damage the church unintentionally, but we must show justice to those who cause the church damage intentionally, and they do exist. Here's an example of those who do it unintentionally. Those who have occasionally lost their struggle with a sinful attitude or behavior, but they certainly not intending to hurt the church. They're just having struggles living up to their own Christian standards, whether they are in leadership or not. Number two, those who've succumbed to a sinful lifestyle, but still believe it's wrong, but they've been overtaken in a sin. The Bible even says to go to those people with grace and humility, considering yourself, lest you also be tempted. But number three are those who carry damaging messages or harbor dangerous beliefs because they've been deceived. Their intent is not to hurt the church. They just haven't been trained properly or taught properly, and they believe something that's flawed. And over this month, you're going to see that some of the most popular movements in Christianity, when you step back and look at them impartially, are really quite dangerous. And we're not going to name any churches in Sarasota. That would be a little bit presumptuous. But we're going to name some national personalities and their influences, because their message is well known and being openly embraced. So then you have the unintentional damage to the church. Then you have the intentional, and that's what we're going to address in this series and tonight. Those who seek to corrupt the Christian message to advance their own agenda, but they present it as if they are not corrupting the Christian message, but their real intent is to tear this down so they can build their agenda up. Matthew 7:15, Jesus said, "Beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravenous wolves." That's one of the great iconic metaphors of literature and Christianity, of a wolf in sheep's clothing. Well, the wolf was not coming there to be friends with the sheep, although he might be presenting himself as a friend of the sheep. He's coming there to consume the sheep and take them from the herd. The Bible says, Jesus warned us, false prophets are coming who will do just that. 2 Peter 2:1-3. "There were also false prophets among the people, even as there will be false teachers among you." Now, this is in the first century. The church has just been born. "Who will secretly bring in destructive heresies, even denying the Lord who bought them, and bring on themselves swift destruction." That doesn't mean it will happen immediately when they do it, but it means when it comes, it'll be, you won't be able to hold it back. "And many will follow their destructive ways, because of whom the way of truth will be blasphemed. By covetousness, they will exploit you with deceptive words." This is Peter talking to the early church. False prophets are coming. I was a victim of that for the first 13 years of my life. I was a member of an actual cult that presented itself openly as being Christian. It was called Christian Science. But in Christian Science, Christ is redefined. He is presented in glowing terms, admirable terms. But he's not the Savior who died to save you from your sin, because sin doesn't even exist. It's that perversion without demeaning openly who Jesus is, but it's the denial of him and redefining of him that's taking place right now in churches all across the country who consider themselves evangelical churches, and they don't even realize they're doing it. But the leaders who present that message, they do know. But there's many innocent believers who haven't discerned that. And that's what we're going to begin talking about on this Sunday. Jude verse 4. "Certain men have crept in unnoticed." And we'll see on the last Sunday of the series, we dissect Jude 4. That "crept in unnoticed" means with the pure intent of doing damage to something. "Who long ago were marked out for this condemnation, ungodly men, who turn the grace of God into lewdness and deny the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. Mockers in the last time, who would walk according to their own ungodly lust. These are sensual persons who cause divisions, not having the Spirit." Now, this is Jesus' brother, half-brother, warning the church. Not only are they coming, they are already here. If they were already here 2,000 years ago, they're here today. Paul talked about the spirit of the Antichrist, and he said it's not just coming, it's already here. So it would behoove us as Bible believers and children of God to be alert to who or what could be creeping in unaware into our fellowship, whether it's our local church or the body of Christ, who are denying who Jesus is and who God is and are corrupting the faith. 2 Timothy 4:3-4. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, talking about church people, but according to their own desires, because they have itching ears, they will heap up for themselves teachers, and they will turn their ears away from the truth and be turned aside to fables. And we're going to expand on that a little bit in this series coming up as to what fables are now popular in the Church of Jesus Christ today that weaken faith. I had an example I think I've mentioned to you before, but years ago, there was a popular Bible teacher, and it was a statement that, well, there was more than one, but there's a he and there's a she, who said this statement, and the church embraced it, and many Christians, even here at our church, were saying it, and that is that God wants us to be happy. And they used the phrase from John where Jesus said, I came to give you life and give it more abundantly. And what could abundant mean but for us to be totally happy? And so God's purpose is for a Christian to be happy. Well, if you embrace that as a truth, and it sounds good when you first hear it, because surely God doesn't want us miserable. He doesn't want us unhappy. Surely that can't be true. So yes, he wants us happy. If you embrace that, then you can extend from it. Well, then what does not make me happy is bad. What does not make me happy can be eliminated. What does not make me happy is not required of me, because God wants me happy. That's step two. Then from that is, then my spouse makes me awful unhappy. My restraint I've lived my life under makes me very unhappy. Whatever list comes next makes me very unhappy. Therefore, I can remove it. There's a great call in Christianity today for finding your authentic self. And to find your authentic self is to finally realize who you truly are in God's eyes and live that out. And that sounds really good, but the application of it is to stop restraining your natural appetites, because that's who you authentically are. And you won't know who you really are until you bust free from all the restraints of Christianity and then give up to that God who you really are with all your appetites and indulgences. And it's portrayed in such a way that churches all across America are saying amen to that. And some of the best-selling books in Christianity promote that. And the sad thing is there are well-intended believers who don't see that as being false doctrine or even dangerous or even defiant. They think it's fulfilling God's design for them to be happy and for them to self-actualize and realize their full potential. And I'm not trying to be funny when I say this, or to have their best life now. That's a subtle message that we need to be careful of. So Tim Challis from the Grace Fellowship Church in Toronto, Ontario, summarized the types of false prophets. And I want to share with you how he defined them, because it serves as a good working model for us to assess what comes our way in the days ahead. And I want you to know I'm expressing this not as if our church is perfect, and certainly not as if I am perfect, or that we're doing everything right and that everybody else in Sarasota is wrong. That's not the point of this message and this series. It's to help us fully know convincingly what the truth is, so when a counterfeit presents itself, we can recognize it. The problem with identifying all the counterfeits, and I'll list some of them for you on Sunday, and some of those that we've done extensive series on here at church, is that it keeps changing its face. It never stops. And you can end up exposing some false thing every single week after week after week after week, and it would be a never ending. But if we all know what the truth is, we ourselves can read something and say, that's not right. hear something and say, now that's not right, if we all know what the truth is. And that's the focus of what I'd like to share with you. But in terms of this study and this charge by Jesus that false prophets will come into your midst wearing sheep's clothing and they're really wolves, how might you recognize who these wolves would be? The first one, according to Chalice's breakdown, is the heretic. And that's somebody who teaches what is blatantly oppositional to the essential doctrines of Christian faith. And there's two things we're fighting to hold on to, faith and the faith. And what Paul talks about is defending the faith. What American Christianity often focuses on is faith itself, as a almost as if it's the force in Star Wars, an energy system, a power conduit, that if we can get that right, everything else just turns out the way that we want. Well, Paul tells us to defend the faith, which is a core set of doctrines and dogma about who Jesus is, what he has done, and who we are. Well, the heretic will openly oppose that. He'll contradict it, he or she will add to it or misrepresent it entirely. And often the way the heretic does that is by either diminishing or disregarding biblical authority or saying, I believe the Bible is the Word of God, but this is what it says. Again, Christian Science, what I practiced, what my dad taught for the first 13 years of my life, took that route. They upheld the Word of God as a sacred, glorious book. Read it, but then set it aside and read Mary Baker Eddy's Science and Health and Key to the Scriptures, because that will tell you what this amazing, wonderful, glorious, God-inspired book says. But to read this without this, you're going to get deceived, so you have to have this. And through that attachment, this led us away from this. And I was a firm believer in Mary Baker Eddy's Science and Health and Key to the Scriptures, The Cross and the Crown, saying Onward Christian Soldiers, it seemed like almost every Sunday, fully believing the Bible is the Word of God, but I didn't know what the Bible said. So one day, when the gospel was presented to me without the filter of Christian Science in front of it, I embraced it, and it changed my life. That's what a heretic does. Openly presents oppositional truth as being true. You have the charlatan. The charlatan uses Christianity as a means of personal enrichment. And I've thought of this many times. I can't think of the man's name, but it was back in the 70s. He was a television preacher, a very popular one out of New York. He was on all the time. He was on at nighttime, seemed like 24 hours a day. And I remember watching him preach on Romans 12, renewing your mind, renewing your spirit, being honorable and pleasing to God, giving yourself a living sacrifice by renewing your mind. And then for a $50 contribution to his ministry, he would give you the principles of how to renew your mind. And he was breaking in millions of dollars at that time. The charlatan sees Christianity as a means of personal enrichment. Therefore, when they read Scripture and they hear things being said, they look for phrases that they can use to manipulate others to donate to them. And they will present it in the most high-sounding reason. But all you have to do, as they say, is follow the money and see who is benefiting from the offerings, and you'll often see who the charlatan is. Paul said to Timothy, he describes it as this: a charlatan is somebody who imagines that godliness is a means of gain. So what did Paul say to Timothy? Godliness with contentment is great gain. But the message of the charlatan is godliness with financial abundance is great gain, and you give to me, I'll show you how it can happen for you. That's the charlatan. Number three is the prophet. The prophet is somebody who claims to be commissioned by God. They might call themselves a prophet. They might call themselves an apostle. They might call themselves a bishop, or they might call themselves somebody who God directly reveals things to in their moments of passionate prayer, but they speak with the authority that I now have truths that are outside of Scripture. Then won't discount the Word of God. But this is new revelation. This is fresh revelation. This is the latter rain. This is the days of Joel prophesied. God is speaking to me directly, and I have a new truth to bring to you that might seem like it's contrary, but it's really just an extension of what Christ said here. That's the prophet. And they're hard to argue with because they speak with the authority, God said this to me. And if God said it to me, doesn't matter what you say, because God spoke to me directly. Years ago, when I was in Buffalo, I had a situation I had to deal with that I had very intimate personal knowledge of with these people involved. And none of that was known by anybody else involved, but I knew it all. And I made some determinations and acted on what I knew to be true and had people come to me to say, God told me you should have done this. Well, knowing what I knew, knowing the truth of what actually happened, I knew God could not have told them that because God surely knows what I know. And these people confessed this to me, that this happened, so I know it happened. So why would God tell them something opposite of what truth is? But you can't divulge that private information, but you also can't talk them out of it. When somebody thinks God has spoken to them directly, you can't argue with it. Well, there are people in tremendous places of influence today who are saying in their books, in their sermons, in their videos, this came to me directly from God. Under His anointing, this truth has come to me, and it will be a blessing to you, and you can put your Bible aside because I got something fresh and new for you. What do you do with it? One of the most popular books in Christianity today is Jesus Calling. Jesus Calling is a devotional guide written by a woman that has been edited quite a few times since it first came out, but it's in its first edition. It openly stated this was directly given to her by God. Messages from God for people to read. Not my thoughts, not my devotional thoughts, but these came from God Himself. To me, that's a prophet. And if something comes from God direct, what does that make you if you don't accept it? It makes you the heretic. The prophet holds tremendous sway, and they're growing. As a matter of fact, one of the movements that we'll talk about in the next few weeks, it is now the fastest growing movement in Christianity, and it has people who claim that to be true. They are the modern day prophets and apostles who now are receiving brand new revelation from God. That is so rife with danger and deceit, but it holds such sway because these people are very dynamic personalities. And it's sad to say, for a long time, Christianity has been wrapped up in a celebrity culture where the better the delivery, the bigger the church, the greater the influence. We're all about the style and the presentation. Rather than what's actually being presented, we've lost our ability to discern. And I think it's because we neglect His Word so much. We like music. And we like the exciting speaker. And we like the exciting church that we're starting to lose the idea of Christianity is heart to God. One individual, right with God. And that's only done through the Holy Spirit. The next one is the abuser. The abuser uses his position of leadership to take advantage of other people in three primary ways. His finances, to enhance his own finances or her own finances. Number two, to extend his or her power or influence to build their Christian empire or business or industry, or to indulge his or her sexual appetites. And does all three of those, or two of those, or one of those, sometimes all three, in the name of God, claiming to be anointed of God. And that these contributions are actually done in service to God. That's the abuser. The next is the divider. Uses false doctrine or correct doctrine applied incorrectly to disrupt or destroy a church. Brings strife and factions, not love and unity. He desires discord, not harmony, undermines and supplants authority within the church family so that he or she eventually becomes the authority. When the divider is already in power, the divider is the one who would say, don't touch God's anointed. Pointing back to how David wouldn't touch Saul because Saul was God's anointed, therefore you can't speak out against the pastor because I'm God's anointed. And if you want to speak out against me, bad things are going to come your way. That's the divider who has already risen to power. The divider does what that old tradition says, divide and conquer, causes discord among people, so they rise as the answer person, the one who can really be trusted. The next example of a false prophet, Chalice calls the tickler. It doesn't mean to make you giggle. He means tickling the ears. It's the false teacher who cares for nothing for what God wants and everything for what people want. He's a man pleaser rather than a God pleaser. So he or she will speak much about happiness, but very little of sin and confession and repentance. We'll talk a great deal about heaven, but we'll not talk about hell. He gives the people only what they want to hear, and he preaches a partial gospel, which is not really the gospel at all. Now, these things are just generalizations, but I think as we go through this series, you'll begin to see who these people are with faces on today. And we have to do it with, again, with great humility and cautiousness and sensitivity, but I think it would be a disservice for us not to be aware that these personalities exist, or these persons exist in Christianity today. And there's one more, and we'll be done. That's the speculator. So we have the heretic, the charlatan, the prophet, the abuser, the divider, the tickler. That's the one that Paul referred to with Timothy, that people will heap to themselves teachers who will tell them what they want to hear. Then the speculator. This is the one obsessed with novelty, originality, or speculation. The teaching is focused on speculation. It displaces the sure and steady doctrine of Scripture, often even tosses Scripture aside, and the bulk of the content of the Bible and the weight of the Bible's emphasis on a brokenness before a holy, righteous God and the embracing of the gospel and then the responsibility to live holy lives. They grow weary of the old truths and they pursue originality. They pursue presentation. They look to see what is the hot topic in the culture and they jump on that. And sometimes it's the hot topic in the Christian culture. If you've ever listened to Rush Limbaugh, and now they often do it on Fox News, Rush Limbaugh used to have a shtick in his presentation where he would have his editors splice together a phrase that everybody in the leftist media would say in that one given day. And his point was that somebody is deciding what the hot topic is, what the hot phrasing is today, and sure enough, NBC, ABC, MSNBC, MSN, all of these guys will all use the exact same phrase that is a very unique, that's not the right term, a unique phrase. That how do they all come up with that? It's because somebody did, and it's the hot topic of the day. And he would do that again and again and again to the point that you could see it yourself just by watching the news and saying, how do they all come up with the same phrase to describe what's going on? Well, that's what the speculator does. He looks for what's being said and jumps on that bandwagon, and he or she, the purpose of that is to build the assembly, to make it grow, to have it be popular. The problem with speculation is that often the marching orders of the current culture are not in keeping at all with the call of God. Os Guinness has a great book, and I just drew a blank on the name. It's Prophetic Untimeliness. It's one of my favorite books. It's a short little book. You can get it and read it yourself. Os Guinness, Prophetic Untimeliness. And he says a true man of God or a true church will often find themselves going against even the Christian current, because to be a messenger of God often means you're speaking to the culture, stop, go the other way. Well, the speculator jumps on the boat and helps the boat paddle. It wants to absorb the energy of wherever the church might be going. It's the prophets who stood up and spoke out against slavery before the Civil War and ignited that debate where many Christians had fallen asleep to even wonder, is slavery wrong? It was such an ingrained cultural value, they had lost sensitivity to it. It was the prophetic timeliness of Christian leaders who said, that's immoral. That's wrong. That's a creation of God. And it took, of course, a bloody civil war to resolve that. But that's the role of the church. Sometimes a humble, loving, kind, gracious, giving, generous Christian ministry has to denounce sin and has to point out a flaw. Who else is going to do it to the culture if it's not us? Well, the speculator will never do it. The speculator will stay away from anything controversial until the controversial becomes popular. And we've seen it now, which will might even get this taken off YouTube if I even say this. But for centuries, at least for decades, evangelical churches had a pretty good understanding that homosexuality was biblically unsupportable. That is no longer the popular stance of evangelical churches. If they even address it, we must take time to make sure that we know we still love the homosexual, but homosexuality might be questionable, and we have to really walk around it. Well, how did we get there? It was a slow move, but now the tidal weight of evangelicalism is we must embrace the LGBTQ movement and disregarding 2,000 years of New Testament principles that say it's an aberration. It's a violation of sexual biblical morality. We can't say that without having a backlash from culture and even being canceled. Well, a speculator knows those things and will never say them. The speculator listens to what is the popular theme of the day and jumps on that and promotes that. Those are all what Timothy Challis calls the false prophets of modern Christianity. And I'm sure there's some crossover and there's some blendings of those. Our challenge is to make sure we as a church that we don't fall into those categories. We will never be perfect, but that we don't intentionally misuse and misrepresent the Word of God to advance our own agenda that profits us in some way. Our pastor shouldn't do it. Our deacons shouldn't do it. Our trustees shouldn't do it. Our Sunday school teachers shouldn't do it. And no member of the church should do it. But to make sure we don't do it, we need to know what that is. And that's what this series will be, knowing the truth so we can follow it faithfully with humility and with dependence upon God to give us discernment so that we can correct ourselves when we ourselves are wrong and just repent of it and change our words or change our behavior when we've been convicted that our words or actions have been wrong. And the only way I know to do that is through the exaltation of the Word of God's truth before the fallacies of our culture and to watch the Holy Spirit take that seed of truth and plant it in people's hearts. But we must do so without being hostile and argumentative and angry. I think we can be loving, kind, gracious, and speak the truth and let the truth do its work. So that'll be this month's series, and we'll start this Sunday with a fairly long introduction, and we'll be talking about the ministry of reconciliation. What is that? And are we doing it? And are we committed to doing that when it might not be the cry of the day, but it certainly is the need of the day? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to discuss this topic that's very sensitive and could certainly offend a lot of people. Lord, that is not our intent. Our intent is to help ourselves, first of all, not fall into false doctrine, and then also to help other believers to stay true to your word, to glorify the Lord Jesus Christ. And we struggle to do that because our hearts and minds are sinful, even though we've been redeemed. We fall into the same misperceptions and misunderstandings that everybody else does. So we ask you to help us to give our allegiance to your word, submit our spirit to your spirit, and help us know the truth so that we can share the truth in grace and truth and love. For we ask that in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, God bless you, and thank you for watching on live stream, and we'll be dismissed from that in just a second. Tom will let me know when we've left live stream.